Chapter 33 of The Barnabys in America by Francis Milton Trollope. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 33. Mrs. Allen Barnaby displays her skill in negotiation. Madame Tornorino appears under a new character. The result of this is likely to be unfavorable to her admirable mother. The danger is skilfully averted. During the space of 10 days or a fortnight, the sincere and steadfast purpose John Williams was fully occupied in canvassing among his friends and acquaintance for such substantial patronage for Mrs. Allen Barnaby's work upon slavery in the United States of America as her peculiar circumstances rendered necessary. Of all canvassing, this species is decidedly the most difficult, let it be carried on where it will. But John Williams was not a man to withdraw himself from an enterprise merely because he found it difficult, and at length his perseverance so far succeeded that he ventured to announce hopes to his client of being able to raise the respectable sum of $500, provided she would agree to make over the copyright of her forthcoming work to a Quaker bookseller, who on that condition had agreed to undertake not only the publication of it, but also the collecting the promised subscriptions for the purpose of paying them over in advance to the authoress. Perhaps my heroine never gave a more decided proof of ready cleverness than on this occasion. She would joyfully have accepted a single dollar in exchange for all the profit she actually anticipated from the publication of her unborn production, but on receiving this magnificent proposal from John Williams, she started, shook her head, sighed, dropped her eyes, and for the space of a minute and a half exhibited with admirable skill all the symptoms of great disappointment, borne with meek patience and resolute philosophy. "Thee dost not like this proposal, friend Barnaby," said the good Quaker, looking at her rather timidly. "Thee dost not think $500 will suffice for thy present necessities?" "Not so, my dear sir," replied the admirable woman, with a modest humility of manner that was very striking. "The sum you name would be quite sufficient for the humble style to which I shall for this object reduce my manner of travelling. It is not that, my kind friend, which causes me to hesitate. But I confess to you that the idea of parting with the copyright of a work which I have reason to believe will be very profitable does startle me. I cannot but indeed consider it equivalent to parting with several $1,000s. "Indeed," returned John Williams, feeling, good man, very much ashamed of having been made the organ of so unjust and ungenerous a proposition. "If that be the case, my good lady, I withdraw the offer with many apologies for having made it."
"Nay, dear sir, do not say that," she replied. "To you I must ever feel deeply grateful. And, moreover, my good friend, we must not lose sight of my very peculiar position. I do not feel that I have the power to refuse this offer, though the terms of it do seem rather severe, for, in fact, without the assistance it promises I can do nothing, and therefore, as you perceive, I must perforce accept it, or abandon at once and for ever an undertaking in which every feeling of my heart is engaged." "I do believe thee, I do believe thee," replied the Quaker, deeply touched by the generous devotion of the poor negro's advocate. "But thy goodness must not be the means of robbing thee of thy fair hopes of honest profit from thy labours. I must see my friend the bookseller again, and endeavour to bring him to reason." "Perhaps, sir," said Mrs. Allen Barnaby timidly, and with the air of a person who knows that he is asking for a good deal, "perhaps, sir, your friend the bookseller might agree to give me 1/4 share of the profits arising from the sale of the work after all expenses, including the advance of $500, shall have been paid."
"Nothing can be fairer or more liberal," replied John Williams, with an eagerness of manner that was almost unseemly in a Quaker. But, in fact, he was greatly delighted at the idea of settling the business in a manner that he thought would be agreeable to all parties. And immediately seizing the stick that ever stood ready in the corner, his ample beaver being already on his head, he declared his intention of immediately seeing the individual whose consent it was necessary to obtain, and left the room with a promise of bringing home the stipulated sum with him, which he would deliver to her, he said, at the same hour on the following morning, being engaged out to dinner with his wife, which would prevent their meeting again that day. Mrs. Allen Barnaby rose from her chair at the same moment that he rose from his, for she had no inclination whatever to remain tête-à-tête with Rachel. That very sensible woman and exemplary wife did not take any trouble to conceal from my quick-sighted heroine that her liking for her did not increase by their lengthened acquaintance.
In fact, though she strictly kept her word to her husband, and did not permit her own feelings or prejudices to be any hindrance to the work which had for its object the welfare of the negro race, she did in honest truth hate and detest Mrs. Allen Barnaby as much as it was well possible for a Christian Quaker to hate anything. She had hailed the first mitigation of brilliance in her as a symptom of seemingly respect to the society of Quakers in general, and to John and Rachel Williams in particular. But not content with this, Mrs. Allen Barnaby had gone on day by day, adding a little Quaker et ceteras to her fitting out, which showed upon her like a white rose stuck in the unshapely ear of an elephant, till the worthy Rachel, who, though a Quaker, had enough of the woman in her to see through such trickery, felt persuaded that she was nothing better than a great overblown cheat, and in pursuance of this unpleasant persuasion spake to her little, and looked at her less, all which being carefully noted by my observant heroine, it is no great wonder that she bustled out of the room the very moment after John Williams left it, with no other leave-taking than a rapidly enunciated, "Good morning, ma'am." Nothing could exceed the air of gay good-humour with which the well-pleased major received his lady's account of what had passed. They were unquestionably a most happily assorted couple, and as if to take instant advantage of the peculiar hilarity of their parents, the Don and his wife knocked at the door of their room just as my heroine had concluded her narrative, and declared that they were come with a joint petition that the whole party might go to the play that evening. No favour was ever asked at a more propitious moment. Both the father and mother were in too happy a state of spirits not to relish any proposal the object of which was gaiety and amusement.
"Off with you, then, Tornarino," exclaimed Patty joyously, "and get the very best places you can."
"Perhaps it will be better for me to undertake that part of the business, especially as I have a notion that one and all of you will look my way for money to pay for them," said the Major.
"You are always a dear darling, Papa, that I will say for you," replied his daughter, her bright eyes positively dancing in her head with glee. "But you can pay the Don, you know, when he comes back, and you'll find that he will get capital good places for you."
Thus reassured, the Major gave up the point, and the interval of the messenger's absence was spent in very lively chit-chat by the parents and their darling daughter, who, to say the truth, was not always equally disposed to bestow the advantage of her charming spirits upon them, when no other person was present to share their admiration. The Don, however, did not linger on his way, but returned with two tickets for front places in one of the best boxes in the house, and these he presented to his august mother-in-law, informing her at the same time that they were the only very good places left, but that he had made an acquaintance with one of the gentlemen of the orchestra who had promised him an order for himself and his wife. "Then Patty shall go with her mother, Tornarino," said the Major good-naturedly. "I won't take a good place while Patty has got a bad one."
"It not be a bad one," returned the Don earnestly. "It be a very good one." "Good or bad, Torny," returned his wife with great vivacity, "it will be no treat to me, you know, if I am to be parted from you, my darling. No, no, Mr. Pap, I know you mean to be very kind, and I thank you accordingly, but I shall sit with the Don, be sure of that."
The Major returned some laughing compliment to her pigeon-like constancy, and promised not to interfere with it again. As my heroine's particular friends were absent from the dinner-table that day, she had little or no opportunity for conversation, for her previous devotion to John Williams had prevented her taking her usual measures to obtain acquaintance with any one else. But Patty was more than usually talkative, and before the repast ended had addressed the interesting question,
"Are you going to the play to-night?"
to no less than five different persons. Three of these, being very dry Quakers, answered in the negative with something not far removed from a grunt or a groan, and of the two others, one said he did not know, while the other so far encouraged her prattling propensity as to inquire if there was to be anything particularly worth seeing in the performance that night. Madame Tornarino's first reply to this very natural question did not sound very civil, for it consisted in a short loud laugh which seemed to indicate that the person who had asked it had been guilty of an absurdity. But having indulged in this mirthful propensity for a minute or two, she settled her features into more than usual gravity and said,
"Upon my word, sir, I don't quite know, but we heard there was to be a new performer, didn't we, Don Tornarino?"
"Mais oui," returned her husband, bowing to the inquirer. "There will be a debut to-night."
"Then I shall certainly go," said the gentleman to whom he addressed himself, adding, "That is just what I like best." And hereupon Patty laughed again. Upon which her mother, a good deal shocked at her rudeness to the very well-dressed gentleman who appeared to occasion her mirth, said in an audible aside to the Major, "The dear creature is in such spirits at the idea of going to the theatre to-night that she is ready to laugh at everything.
an observation which was fully justified by her daughter suddenly clapping her hands with the most naive appearance of irrepressible glee and again bursting forth into a fit of merriment so genuine that it was almost impossible not to join in it. "What were you laughing at, Patty?" said her father, taking her arm as the party were dispersing after dinner. "I declare, my dear, I think you grow younger as well as handsomer every day. Doesn't she, Tornorino?"
"Oh, she is a bien belle femme," replied Tornorino, at the same time whispering something in her ear. "And you are a beautiful man, my darling," she replied, withdrawing her arm from her father. "And he is going to give me another treat," she added, "for he says I must take a delightful walk with him before the play, and so I shall set off this very moment." "Why, Patty, you will be tired to death," said her mother, "so dreadfully hot as it is. Upon my word, you had much better lie down instead of trotting out in the sunshine." "Thank ye for nothing, mamma," replied the lively beauty, snapping her fingers. "My husband always knows what is best for me, don't you, Don? So good-bye, dear pop and ma'am, and the next time you see me, I hope you'll find that I am not at all the worse for my walk."
"Stay, Patty, stay," cried her father, calling after her as she walked off towards her own room with her Don. "I suppose you mean to come back in time to walk to the theatre with us?"
"Upon my word, I don't suppose any such thing," returned his daughter gaily. "At any rate, pap, you had better not wait for us," she added, "because, as we are not going to sit together, there is no use in our bustling back just to be in time for you. I won't say but what I shall spend a levy that I have got in the corner of my pocket in treating the Don with an ice, so that most likely we shall not come back at all."
As no very reasonable objection could be made to this conjugal arrangement, the young couple were suffered to walk off without further opposition, while the seniors entered their own retreat together.
"Perhaps it is quite as well, Major," said my heroine, "that they should leave us a little to ourselves this evening, for it is quite necessary that we should talk over what we have got to do next. I suppose we may reckon upon receiving these $500 to-morrow morning, and the sooner we can be off afterwards, the better I presume you will be pleased."
"Decidedly, my Barnaby," replied her husband. "But don't you think, my dear," he added, after meditating upon the subject for a minute or two, "don't you think that there will be something rather awkward in our running away the very moment you have got the money from them? Don't you think it will look odd?"
"Not the least in the world, Donny," replied his wife, with very prompt decision. "You forget that the very purpose for which I am to receive it renders it absolutely necessary for me to travel with all the perseverance and activity possible into the other free states. New York, you know, is one of them, and as it is there we most wish to go, why should we not set off for it to-morrow? There are steamers going 2 or 3 times a day."
"If you have no objection, my dear, I am sure I have none. For, to tell you the truth, I never hated a place so much in my life," returned her husband. "I never sit down to table without feeling as if I were put in the stocks. Confound their solemn faces, they positively give me the cramp." This short dialogue sufficed to settle the question as what they were to do next, and that no time might be lost, they employed themselves till it was time to set off for the theatre, in collecting together whatever had been unpacked, and putting all things in order for departure.
"There," said Mrs. Allen Barnaby, as she turned the key of her trunk with a very satisfactory snap. "Now I shall be able to help Patty to-morrow, for, as we well know, she is always behindhand." Having completed this business, and been favoured with an early cup of tea in their own apartment, they set off for the theatre. "Buy a bale, Donny," said my heroine, as they passed through the lobby. The request was complied with, and having reached the places secured for them, the Major politely placed the playbill in his lady's hand. Her spectacles were immediately applied, for, alas, the beautiful Barnaby had reached the time at which they were necessary, and she proceeded to examine the bill of fare for the evening's amusement.
"Read it aloud, my dear, for you know I can't see in this owl's light," said the Major.
The lady obeyed and read. "The Merchant of Venice."
"Ah, that's a very good play," observed the Major. "I remember seeing it in London. And who is the new performer Patty talked about?"
Mrs. Allen Barnaby applied herself anew to the playbill, and read aloud. "The part of Nerissa by a lady from England being her first appearance."
"Oh, then, it is only some English actress who has never played here before," said the Major. "It does not mean a first appearance."
"I suppose not," replied his wife.
And then she obligingly read aloud the other parts of the bill, even to the name of the printer.
This done, they both set themselves to examine the house, for they had arrived unnecessarily early, and criticized all the people who came into it, and in this way they beguiled the time till the curtain rose. When the scene changed from Venice to Belmont, the stage was for a moment unoccupied, and then two well-bedizened ladies entered at the farther end of it, and walked forward towards the footlights for the first half of the distance in silence, and then conversing. The shorter of the two actresses was the favourite American Portia of the day. But the burst of applause which greeted their entree was evidently as much intended for the maid as the mistress, her novelty being as cordially greeted as the well-known reputation of the other. "What a lovely woman!" was exclaimed by many voices at once.
"The stage is full of dust," said Mrs. Allen Barnaby, rubbing her eyes. "I can't make out their features at all."
The major applied his opera-glass to his eye, and remained in contemplation of the fair creatures before him for several seconds. At length, removing the glass from his eyes, and turning short round towards his wife, he whispered almost in her ear,
"By all that's sacred, wife, that girl in pink is Patty."
"Impossible!" exclaimed the portly lady, looking very much as if she intended to clamber upon the stage over the front of the box, the orchestra, and all the other obstacles.
"She dare not, Donny, she dare not for her life."
The greatly irritated major did not exactly reply in words, "She dare do anything." But his tremendous frown said it for him, and by the time my heroine had herself looked through the glass, the same disagreeable truth impressed itself on her mind also, and she exclaimed in a rage that was equally ill-timed and unprofitable,
"True enough, sir! And who is it that has spoiled her from first to last, and taught her in all ways to be an undutiful monster?"
Mrs. Allen Barnaby was by no means accustomed to give way in public to those little eruptions of warm temper to which she was constitutionally liable. But now the well-behaved major began to fear that she would lose all command of herself, and multiply all the evils of the exposure his high-spirited daughter was bringing upon them. "We had better come away, my dear," he said in the gentlest accents possible. "Nobody will know anything about her if we keep our own secret." Fortunately, the house was by no means crowded, and in the box they occupied, the only persons besides themselves in it, were two lounging men whose whole attention seemed devoted at this moment to the stage. And no great wonder that it should be so. The very striking face and figure of Patty being just then displayed in the manner to make both as striking as possible, and though face, figure, attitude, and dress might all perhaps have been classed as meretricious in their coarse attractiveness, there was, nevertheless, something of youthful brilliance in her appearance which most people would have found it difficult at the first glance to turn away from. Whether either father or mother had sufficient of what may be called a decent refinement to feel all the painful degradation of such an appearance may be doubtful. But both the one and the other were instantly aware that at the moment when they were endeavouring to push their fortune among the wealthy Quaker magnates of the land, such an exhibition of their daughter must be fatal. And this was certainly the feeling which induced them both, without further consultation, to leave the theatre, that they might themselves be as little as possible identified with her. My unfortunate heroine suffered her common sense to get the better of her anger at this critical moment, and, suddenly ceasing her ejaculations, prepared herself to follow her husband's advice and leave the box. It was, as has been already stated, the front seat of this box that they occupied, and Mrs. Allen Barnaby had deposited her shawl on the cushion in front of it. As she took hold of this shawl for the purpose of drawing it away, she became sensible that a hand or some other impediment prevented its yielding to her pull, which she then rendered rather more powerful, but in vain, the shawl yielded not, and the major, who perceived this, immediately bent forward with a hasty movement to discover who or what it was thus delayed the exit that he so impatiently desired. This movement of his was accompanied by one precisely similar on the part of his wife, and thus at the same instant they both perceived the black and yellow physiognomy of their noble son-in-law turned up to greet them, while a flute, which he held in the hand not occupied by the shawl, informed them, by its very intelligible hieroglyphic, why and wherefore it was that he had taken his place in the orchestra of the Chestnut Street Theatre. There was not the slightest mixture of doubt or fear in the expression of the features thus turned up towards them. On the contrary, the Don had probably never met the eyes of his parents-in-law with an aspect so entirely free from both. He seemed to think it was a moment of common triumph to them all, and after having looked at them both with a congratulating grin, he turned his head towards the stage, just as Patty was pronouncing, with very majestical wave of the right arm, "Your father was ever virtuous." and kissing the tips of his fingers, waved the caressing salutation towards her, and pronounced the word "Bravo!" as if involuntarily, but with a degree of unction that drew many eyes upon him. Infinitely provoked at this very unnecessary additional annoyance, the major jerked the shawl very unceremoniously from his fingers, and muttering, "Come along, for heaven's sake," to his wife, hurried out of the box. Not one syllable was spoken by the major between the theatre and the boarding-house, a species of moody silence which appeared to produce a very imposing effect on his wife, for though she was well-nigh bursting with impatience to speak of what had occurred, she produced no sounds more articulate than sighs and groans, till they were fairly concealed from all eyes and ears in the retirement of their own apartment. "How many of your boasted $500, Mrs. Allen Barnaby, do you expect to get from your Quaker friends after this?" said the major, throwing himself into an armchair and freely using the refreshing friction of his silk handkerchief upon his heated brow. "Not a single cent of it, Major Allen Barnaby, if the broad-brims find it out. But we must be quick, my dear, quick as thought. You will do what you like, of course, but this is what I propose. Let us sit watching here till the Williamses return. I have heard them say that they are never late. The moment I hear them enter their room, I will go to them. No, I don't think I could stand that, either. The steady look of her light grey eyes always disconcerts me. All right, Major, that's what I'll do. I will write to him."
"And pray, my dear, if I may be so bold," he replied with something like a sneer, "what do you mean to say?"
"You shall see, Major, you shall see. Of course, I won't send it if you should disapprove."
Mrs. Allen Barnaby said she would be quick, and she was so. In a very short space of time she put the following lines into the hands of her husband.
"My dear Sir, I have received a letter from a friend of mine at Washington who is aware of the object which brought me to this country, informing me that one of those dreadful scenes of abomination, the sale by auction of negro slaves, is to take place there on the 15th. If I start by the 5 o'clock boat to-morrow morning, I shall be in time to witness this, and I feel certain that a description of it written on the spot will do more towards impressing my readers with the emotions I wish to inspire than any other particular upon which I could employ my pen. You know, my dear sir, from the entire unreserve with which I have explained to you my situation, how I am circumstanced at this moment with respect to money, and will therefore fully comprehend of what great importance it will be to me that I should receive the subscription you have raised for me to-night. Should you, my dear sir, have failed in obtaining for me the contingent advantage we talked of in case of an extended sale of my work, I will consent, under the peculiar pressure of the moment, to dispose of my interest in it altogether for the $500 that have been offered me. This sacrifice will be vexatious, but I feel that I ought to submit to it, rather than fail to be the eye-witness of a scene which is calculated to throw so much striking odium upon the system that my soul abhors. I await your reply to this with very anxious impatience. If it be favourable, I shall feel myself ever bound to you, and shall proceed with renovated zeal and courage in my enterprise. But if otherwise, I fear I must abandon it altogether, as my excellent, but on this point mistaken husband, declares that his duty as aide-de-camp and private secretary to the Duke of Wellington will render it impossible for him to indulge me by prolonging much further his absence from home. I remain, dear sir, with the most lively sense of your benevolent kindness, your faithful, humble servant, Martha Allen Barnaby."
Major Allen Barnaby, who really was very proud of his wife, read this epistle twice over with a very approving smile, and then said, "I should be puzzled to improve it, my dear, I promise you. But there is one doubt suggests itself, my Barnaby. What think you would be likely to happen if this broad-brimmed Jonathan should chance to know that no such sale as thee talks of is going to take place?"
"Thee not need alarm thyself," she replied in the same tone. "I am too old a soldier to hazard the success of a stratagem by any such risk."
And extending her hand to the other side of the table at which she had been writing, she took up a newspaper and handed it to him, pointing out the particular passage she wished him to peruse. This was an advertisement of the sale she had mentioned in her letter, and which, by great good luck, she remembered to have read, when she certainly had little thought of turning it to such good account.
"Good! Capital!" exclaimed Major Allen Barnaby with much energy. "If you do but get these $500, my dear, I shall not care that," snapping his fingers, "for Patty's foolish frolic. I hate this place and all the people in it, and shall be heartily glad to get away from it, I promise you.
Not but what I shall be devilishly provoked if these two fools, Tornorino and his wife, are the cause of your losing the reward of your cleverness, which you most certainly will do if your beloved John and Rachel hear of it."
"They are perfectly welcome to hear of it to-morrow at breakfast-time, Donny," returned my heroine, folding and sealing her letter. "And now ring the bell." The major obeyed, Ariadne appeared, and the important letter was dispatched.
On such occasions every moment seemed an age. Nevertheless, the answer arrived so speedily that it was received with the word "Already," pronounced in rather tremulous accents by Mrs. Allen Barnaby. But no sooner had her fingers touched the envelope than hope took the place of fear, for the packet had evidently more than one enclosure, and the moment after hope gave way before certainty, for on opening the said packet two bills for $250 each fell out of it, together with a short letter and a long paper within it. The letter ran thus: "Thee art right, friend Barnaby, in wishing to see with thine own eyes the actual sale by auction of our unhappy fellow-creatures. For this cause I am ready and willing to hasten the business between us to its conclusion, wherefore I send thee $500, together with duplicate engagements from the bookseller, by the which thee wilt perceive that an ultimate interest in thy work is secured to thee. If thee wilt sign one of these papers and send it back, the business will be settled between us for the present. When thy work shall be ready for publication, thee mayest send it directed to John Williams, Philadelphia, and then I will promise thee to be watchful and faithful for thy interests, and take care that when the cost of publication, together with the advance, shall be liquidated by the profits arising therefrom, thy stipulated share of all such profits as shall accrue afterwards shall be punctually forwarded to thy address. Fare thee well, from thy friend, John Williams. Postscriptum. The black servant Ariadne has orders to wait for the agreement to which thee art to affix thy signature." Having read this letter through, Mrs. Allen Barnaby placed it in the hands of her husband with an expressive "hem," and then with a sort of gentle sigh, as if things might have been better with her, she took up the two bills and placed them in a purse, which she drew from her pocket, after which she cast her eyes over the duplicate engagements, signed one of them, placed it in the hands of Ariadne, and dismissed her. There was a good deal of genuine fun in the look with which the major contemplated his lady as the door closed and they found themselves again alone. My heroine, for the first moment or two, ventured not to utter any articulate sound in return, but pursed up her mouth and twinkled her eyes. But as she listened to the retreating steps of Ariadne, she took courage and ventured to say,
"I told you I would be quick, Major Allen Barnaby, and I hope you think that I have kept my word."
"My dear, you are an angel," was his satisfactory reply, adding, however, "but for all that, my Barnaby, I feel as if I were sitting upon a mine. Just fancy their hearing that your daughter was a strolling player and your son-in-law first flute in the orchestra."
"They may hear that, Donny, or anything else within the reach either of truth or invention, as soon as we are beyond reach of hearing them, and that we shall be, my dear, before they all meet at breakfast to-morrow. Till then, I think our secret may be considered as safe."
The major agreed that this was certainly probable, and at once, without indulging any more in speculation on the subject, they both set to work upon the necessary business of the final packing up, and had very satisfactorily completed all they had to do in that way, when Don Tornorino and his lady knocked at the chamber door. It had been previously agreed between the angry parents that the present was no time for remonstrance or reproach, and all that was uttered of either was contained in the information that after this appearance in public it would be impossible for any of them to remain in the city, that everything they could themselves do in the way of preparing for departure had been already done, and that the Don and his wife, instead of retiring to rest, must immediately set about the same work for themselves, unless, indeed, they had made such terms with the manager of the company they had joined as might enable them to support themselves without further assistance, in which case they certainly need not trouble themselves about preparing for removal. Patty clapped her hands and burst into a loud laugh, but her Don stood aghast, and expressed by his countenance every species of humility and repentance that the most severe parents could require. He knew, though his madcap wife did not, that his engagement with the manager consisted solely in having obtained permission for himself and his wife to appear, his lady on the stage and himself in the orchestra.
the result of which experiment had been that the musical part of the establishment had declared that they could not and would not play with Don Tornorino, for that it was a damnation bore to be told every other minute that they were playing out of time, an accusation which, whether just or unjust, they being, one and all, native free-born Americans, were not very likely to take in good part, so that, in fact, he had brought away with him nothing but his congé. His handsome wife, however, had had somewhat better success, having received sundry rounds of applause when she appeared in the clerk's dress, which, to say truth, became her extremely well, so much so, indeed, that the manager had announced a repetition of the piece for another night of the current week, which had been very favourably received by all the clapping and thumping part of the audience. This convinced the Don at once that his lady was a theatrical treasure, and while she was in the act of exchanging the much-admired clerk's dress for her usual habiliment, he made his way to the presence of the manager, and, stating the necessity for an immediate decision, requested to know what terms Madame Tornorino and himself might hope for. What the answer was in his own case had been already stated, but in that of his lady it was rather less decisive. "Your wife, Monsieur, has no more notion of acting than a possum," said the manager, "but I expect, too, that she is a considerable fine young woman, and therefore I shall have no objection to engage with her for a reasonable salary, if she has no objection to stick to the boys' parts." Tornorino's only reply was a request to be made acquainted with the gentleman's notion of a reasonable salary. The amount named might, with economy, have sufficed to keep Patty in silk stockings and pumps, and although this, when communicated to the beauty, had appeared to her the very perfection of independence, her more experienced spouse knew better, and became quite aware of the disagreeable fact that he and his fair bride had still no resource to look to for their daily bread but the well-guarded pocket-book of the major. No wonder, therefore, that the gentle hint now given by that gentleman, signifying that if Patty chose to continue her public career, she must choose also to live by it, threw him into a state of agitation which for a moment robbed him of all power of protesting against this terrible sentence. But while her terrified husband was struggling for breath, Patty was well enough disposed to answer in his stead. "Pack up!" she exclaimed. "Capital notion that, Mr. Papp, for a first-rate actress, who is so much the fashion as to be obliged to repeat the part with only 2 days' interval. Pack up, indeed! I shall just pack up when the rest of the ladies at the theatre do, and not 1 minute before, you may depend upon it." "It is settled, then, Patty," said the major, looking frowningly enough between anger and sorrow. "No more need be said about it, so I wish you good night. We leave this place at 5 o'clock to-morrow morning, so I suppose there is no great chance of our meeting again."
"Then you are a fool for your pains, Papa, and a bit of a brute, too, I must say, not to stay and witness the success and the fashion and the fame of your only child. Much you must love me, to be sure, mustn't you?"
The major felt at that moment that he did love her, notwithstanding all her saucy impertinence, and feeling a little of the paternal vanity of which his fair daughter thought he ought to feel a great deal, he turned to his son-in-law and said, "Does she mean to tell me, Tornorino, that her playing was successful?"
"Santa Maria, no!" cried the Don, suddenly recovering his voice. "Dear sir, it was a capriccio of your beautiful daughter. To her I can refuse nothing in the whole world. And so I, like a fool bête, let her try. But it not do, sir, it not do at all. They offers her so little bit money as not keep her pretty beauty alive. We go pack, this very moment, belle Patty."
"What an abominable sneak you are, Don!" cried Patty, colouring through her theatrical rouge like scarlet. "I do despise you from the very bottom of my heart, and if I do pack up, it shall be just on purpose to leave you behind, so put that in your pipe and smoke it, you poor cowardly fellow that's afraid of being scolded by Papa. You don't deserve such a wife as I am, that you don't, and if I keep my present mind, you shall never have me again. Smoke that, too, Mr. Don."
"Hush, hush, Patty," said the major. "You are behaving a great deal worse than the Don, I promise you. It is lucky for you that he has come to his senses before we have left you to starve, which I give you my word and honour we should have done if he had not been more reasonable than you are. Get away with you, you foolish girl, do. You may kiss me if you will, and part friends, upon condition that you never take any such nonsense into your whirligig of a head again. If it was not for your mother's uncommon cleverness, we should have got into a terrible scrape, I promise you, and have found ourselves just $500 the poorer for your frolic."
"Make me believe that if you can,"
cried the incorrigible Patty, turning away without giving the slightest indication of intending to grant the invited kiss.
"I shall just go to bed, for I am as tired as a dog, and if my sneaking Don chooses to pack up, he may, but I'd see him hang 10 times over before I'd do it."
And with these tender words, very pointedly addressed to the chosen of her heart, the young beauty made her exit, brushing with an air of defiance by her mother, who, on her part, felt greatly too angry to speak without betraying more warmth than she thought it prudent to display, as she by no means wished to attract the attention of any of their Quaker neighbours to their room at that particular moment. Flattering himself that there was no immediate danger that he and his gentle helpmate should be thrust out from the snug shelter of the parental wing, the Don wisely abstained from any further display of deprecating eloquence, and followed his wife, bowing gracefully to Pap and Mam as he passed. Both the Major and his lady were, in every sense of the phrase, wide awake on the following morning at a very early hour, and while the gentlemen sallied forth to secure the services of a porter to convey their luggage to a steamboat, the lady, notwithstanding her wrath, condescended to visit the apartment of her daughter to ascertain if she too, with her less guilty husband, were ready for departure. Instead of this, however, she found both the Don and his lady profoundly asleep, and even when she had removed this impediment to their activity by shaking them both heartily, she had the mortification of hearing Patty declare, in her most contumacious tone, that whether it were early or late she did not care a straw, and that she would have her sleep out if Old Nick himself came to shake her. It is probable that Mrs. Allen Barnaby might have tried the effect of more effective measures still, had she not, at the very moment that her daughter thus expressed herself, fancied that she heard the door, enclosing the apartments of John and Rachel Williams, open. The possibility of their having heard of Patty's theatrical exhibition last night, and of their coming upon her for obtaining money under false pretences, as they now appeared under circumstances totally different from what they had represented, occurred to her with such force that she instantly resolved to leave the house, wait for the return of her husband in the street, and make him escort her on board the steamboat before he removed their trunks or paid any further attention to their contumacious daughter. The project could not, of course, be communicated either to the already snoring Patty or her only half-awake husband, but as she withdrew from the bed she said with sufficient emphasis to attract the attention of the drowsy Don, "We are going to leave the house directly, but if you will stay in it, you must." She then left the room, and was on the pavement of the street in pursuit of the Major, before her alarmed son-in-law had fully accomplished the difficult task of waking his wife. The lookout service of my heroine did not last long, for she had scarcely closed the house door behind her before she saw the Major approaching.
"The Quakers are all on the alert this morning, and I have heard the door of the Williamses open and shut," she said, as soon as he was within reach of a safe whisper, for the black lad who followed him with the truck made any louder communication dangerous. "I have got the $500 in my pocket, Donny," she added in the same cautious tone, "and my opinion is that I and the dollars, too, will be a great deal safer out of the house than in it."
"Egad, I'm afraid so, upon my soul, if the Williamses are really stirring, for their movements are as regular as those of the clock on the staircase," returned the Major, knitting his brows with a look of considerable anxiety. "A pretty business we shall have made of it, to be sure, if they have really found out this mad trick of Patty's, and choose to blow up a riot and expose us to the whole town. Not to mention the loss of the money, which of course we must give back if they choose to declare that we introduced ourselves under false colours, or we shall have the devil and all to do with the police at our heels."
"I'll see every man, woman, and child of them, black, white, and yellow, slaves and freeborns, old and young, rich and poor, at the bottom of the sea before I'll give back a single farthing of the money," returned Mrs. Allen Barnaby, with a degree of animation which would certainly have startled the black porter had he been within hearing. But the Major had prudently ordered him to go on to the house and wait in the hall till he came. He therefore listened to this vehement reply without any feeling of displeasure or alarm, and even expressed his perfect approbation of the sentiments she expressed, adding, very gently, that he only feared her noble daring might eventually lead her into a scrape. "Don't talk nonsense, Donny," was the prompt reply. "If I am once safely stowed on board the Lady Washington steamer, I will bet my $500 to your gold snuff-box that I shall reach New York just as safely, my dear, as you reached Philadelphia. And if they were to lay hands upon me, what have they got to accuse me of, I should like to know? Have I not made over to them a legal claim to all the profits that shall accrue from my work? have I manifested by word, act, or deed, the very slightest intention of swerving from my bargain?"
"All true, my dear. But why, then, do you feel it necessary to run away in such a hurry?"
"Merely to avoid the disagreeable necessity, if that grey tabby-cat Rachel should come and clutch me with her sly, velvet-like claws, and beg me civilly to return the money, because the society of friends don't approve acting people of saying in reply, 'I won't.'"
"True again, my Barnaby, you are a trump, and no one, whether king, queen, knave, or ace, need be ashamed to bow before you. You wish, then, to go on board instantly?"
said the major.
"Yes," she replied, "instantly. It will look more respectable, you know, for you just to hand me on deck, and then you may be back in a moment and see to the moving of everything. As to those silly fools, Patty and her husband, I believe they are still in bed, for I could not make them get up. But you must not wait for them, mind. Just give Tornorino money enough to come by the next boat."
Mrs. Allen Barnaby was politely handed on board without further loss of time by her observant husband, who immediately hurried back according to her instructions, and manfully assisted in removing his own and his lady's baggage from their room to the truck. As he mounted the stairs with his assistant black porter for the last load, he encountered Ariadne, who was evidently moving down with a very eager step to find him. She bore in her hand a neat-looking little note addressed to Mistress Allen Barnaby, and for an instant he was about to open it, the excellent terms on which he lived with his admirable wife fully justifying such a liberty. Yet had he done so, he would most unquestionably have proved himself for ever unworthy of possessing such treasures as herself and her confidence. But happily a ray from her own spirit seemed suddenly to flash across him.
"Mrs. Allen Barnaby is gone," said he very composedly to the black help. "But I shall join her again very soon, and will take care to give her this note the moment I see her."
"But friend Rachel and friend John, too, wanted an answer immediately," said Ariadne. "Massa best read it own self."
"That is never done in our country," replied the major, solemnly shaking his head, "and you may tell friend John and friend Rachel that I say so. But I will keep it for her very carefully." And so saying, he demurely took out his pocket-book and placed the note in one of its pockets. Ariadne, notwithstanding her freedom, could venture no further remonstrance, and returning with this answer to the apartment of the Quakers, would probably have brought a second and a personal application from John Williams, had he not been still in bed. He instantly, however, began investing himself in such garments as were necessary for making his appearance, and nothing but the vigorous activity of the major prevented his having to undergo an interview, which would certainly have been very far from agreeable. Most fortunately, however, upon his opening the door of Tornorino's room, in order to toss into it the dollars which his wife had desired him to leave with the offending young couple, he met the Don coming forth with his own portmanteau on his shoulder and that of his wife's dragging after him with his disengaged hand, while Patty herself, though looking as black as a thundercloud, followed behind him, bringing a huge carpet-bag. "This fellow will help you," said the major, pointing to the grinning black porter. "I cannot stay an instant, and you had better not. Follow this black fellow and his truck to the wharf." These words, which were spoken as the major descended the stairs, sufficed to frighten Patty a little, and her husband a good deal. Not a moment was lost. The remaining trunks were partly carried and partly kicked downstairs, the noble hands of the Don disdained not to assist in placing them on the truck, and the convoy was just under way as John Williams stepped forth from his own room door upon the stairs. Had he not stepped back for his stick, he must have overtaken it. But this delay gave time to turn the corner, and when he stepped forth into the street, not a single living object was to be seen, save a very hungry-looking little cur, which at that moment was passing the steps, and which, on seeing him, trotted up them, looking piteously in his face. "Poor beast! Thee art homeless," said the kind-hearted man, stepping back into the hall and calling to Ariadne, who was passing it for a plate of broken victuals for a poor dog. He again looked up the street and down the street for any passenger who might be able to tell him if he had met a party going to the steamboat with some luggage. But nobody was to be seen, the long and handsome street being vacant from end to end. "And what matters it?" soliloquized the Quaker, as he again retreated into the house. "I do believe that the whole set are not much better than they should be, but I would rather feed a hungry dog any day than catch and scourge a vicious one. But my Rachel was right. There is no doubt about that." End of chapter 33.
Chapters 34 and 35 of The Barnabys in America by Francis Milton Trollope. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 34. Circumstances render it advisable for Major Allen Barnaby and his family to remove from Philadelphia. They make a pleasant voyage to New York and again take up their quarters at a first-rate boarding-house. The embarkation of the whole party, the lingering Tornarinos and their baggage included, had very much the air of a regular escapade. All the men, women, and children around them, however, were too completely occupied by their own concerns to bestow any great attention upon those of others till the bustle was over and the Lady Washington steamboat fairly under way. As the steam hissed and the paddles played, Mrs. Allen Barnaby smiled, rejoicing with no common joy at being thus quittée pour la peur of an interview with her dear friend John Williams. His letter, however, was still unopened and still to be read, and the major gently hinted that it might perhaps be as well to look at it, just for the sake of civility, though, of course, going at the rate they did, its contents could signify but little, as all that was at all important in the negotiation between them had been completed by her receiving the dollars, and there could be no danger of their being overtaken in time to undo it. However, the major and his lady retired to an unoccupied spot upon the deck, where the letter being opened and lovingly held between them, they read together the following words. Friend Barnaby, thee hast not, it may be, intended to deceive us, but whether intending it or not, thou hast done so. It may be that in thy eyes and in those of thy people, the young men and women who minister to the pleasures of the worldly, by exhibiting themselves upon the stage, are in no way rendered thereby unfit to associate with such persons as Rachel Williams, but it is not so with us. Neither should I, nor those who act with me, be well pleased to purchase the cooperation of a female who permits her young daughter to appear clothed in man's attire before the eyes of our fellow citizens. Wherefore, friend Barnaby, I do require of thee to restore unto me the money which I have unwarily put into thy hands, and be advised by me, for thy own good, to abstain henceforth from intermeddling or intermixing with the society of friends, for the which thy habits and opinions render thee in no way suitable. Thee mayest return the notes by the steady female who will deliver this into thy hands, or I will call upon thee to receive the same as soon as thee shalt be stirring and ready to see me. I remain thy friend, John Williams. The major looked down upon the merry upturned face of his wife with so comical a leer that it made her laugh outright, in which gay humour he joined very cordially for a minute or two, and then, recovering his gravity, said very demurely, "Well, my dear, what do you wish to do about it?"
"Wish?" she replied in the same tone. "Why, my dear, I wish he may get it."
To which piece of the facetiousness she added,
"And I wish also that the fishes may come in for their share of this very profitable transaction."
And then, suiting the action to the word, she withdrew the letter from her husband's hand, and, tearing it into very little bits, dropped it by sundry instalments into the waves, which their rapid movement caused to froth and foam as it hurried past them. Their passage to New York was agreeable in every way. The weather was fine, the sea calm, the breakfasts, dinners, and suppers abundant, and their spirits very considerably above par. Even Patty was in a good humour, notwithstanding her forced exit, for she was amusing herself by arranging lots of schemes for the future, by which she and her beautiful Don might emancipate themselves from the tyranny of the old Fogrums, and return to what it was very evident must in the end secure them very large fortunes as well as fun for everlasting. The terror into which the Don himself had been thrown, by what he knew perfectly well was a positive failure, rendered the sort of tacit forgiveness and restoration to favour which he had found at the hands of his august parents-in-law very like a return to paradise. His precious Patty had never yet known what it was to be hungry without having the means of satisfying the craving. But he had, and this made a very remarkable difference in the value they respectively set upon the paternal protection. However, he by this time knew his beloved too well to risk the harmony which at present existed between them, by venturing to hint at any such dull realities, and continued to listen to her plots and plans, her hopes and wishes, her intentions and resolves, with an approving smile that rendered anything like a dispute impossible. At length the beautiful commercial metropolis of the Western world was reached. The beams of the setting sun danced over the waves, which, however sheltered from the winds, were for ever and ever agitated by the oars, the paddles, and the keels of ceaseless industry, and the whole scene was so animated and so brilliant that even the languid Tornarino exclaimed,
"N'est-ce pas beau, Patty?"
Our amiable and sociable travellers had, as usual, contrived to make acquaintance with some of their fellow passengers, and by dint of answering all questions readily, and with a judicious mixture of admiration of the glorious country, and insinuations of their own high station in the humble little island from whence they came, their progress from the Battery to the most fashionable boarding-house in Broadway was marshalled by two members of Congress and a senator, who all seemed anxious to testify their goodwill towards strangers so every way respectable. On reaching the boarding-house no questions were asked about recommendations. They entered with Mr. Crop, Mr. Griskin, and Mr. Fad. This was recommendation enough, for besides their legislative honours, Mr. Crop was a general merchant in an enormous way of business, Mr. Griskin a partner in 17 banks in different towns of the Union, and Mr. Fad the editor of 3 newspapers and 9 other weekly or monthly periodicals, all of which he thought might benefit by intimate association with so liberal and well-informed a traveller as the major had already proved himself to be. A few words from each of the distinguished gentlemen whispered in a little side parlour to the head of the establishment were sufficient to procure for our wanderers the very best rooms vacant in the house, as well as every other boarding-house attention calculated to make them feel, in the native phrase, quite at home. It was not, however, till the following day that my heroine and her daughter burst upon the large party domesticated at Broadway House in full splendour, and then they were immediately acknowledged by all the company as a pair of the most first-rate females that had appeared from the old country for a long spell. It was indeed a prodigious relief to Mrs. Allen Barnaby to find herself released from the Quaker restraint which she had submitted to at Philadelphia, and she certainly made the most of the opportunity now offered of showing off her nice things as well as her nice self. Patty was, as usual, exceedingly brilliant, and as no city of the known world sets a higher value upon fine dresses than New York, the result of this display was extremely satisfactory. "A person must be somebody to wear such a velvet and such lace as Mrs. Allen Barnaby," was the acute observation of one lady. "And it was impossible a mere nobody could wear such rich satin as Madame Tornorino for a mere ordinary dinner-party at a boarding-house," said another. The estimate formed of the major and his son-in-law was equally favourable, the former being pronounced to be about the best pattern of an Englishman that had been sent out, and the Don declared to be, especially by the ladies, a perfect model of a man, particularly as to his whiskers. The agreeable impressions thus produced by the appearance and manners of the strangers led to a proposition in favour of the Major and the Don, which was by no means usual at an American boarding-table. Instead of dispersing here, there, and everywhere, as soon as the operation of eating was over, the gentlemen of the party gathered round the new-comers as the ladies left the room, and civilly proposed that they should take their cigars together, either with wine or spirit, as might be most agreeable to the Europeans. The proposition was, of course, as amiably received as made, for no man ever saw Major Allen Barnaby decline so favourable an opportunity of making himself acquainted with the statistics of any new region into which his eventful life might have led him. Whatever the Major did on such occasions, of course, the Don did also, so that in a very few minutes after the table was cleared of the meats and the room of the ladies, a knot of 7 gentlemen were snugly drawn together at the upper part of the board, with spirits, sugar, water, wine, cigars, tobacco, and whatever else such a party were likely to require for the purpose of making themselves comfortable. Now, this was exceedingly frank and hospitable, that is to say, nationally, not individually hospitable, for, of course, every man was to pay his own expenses on the occasion. But, as far as it went, it rather exceeded the usual bounds of civility manifested under similar circumstances. Every effect, however, has a cause, and so had this. Perhaps there is no city upon the earth to which, in proportion to its size, so great a number of speculative adventurers resort as New York. Every man, therefore, who appears there, without introductions announcing his avowed and specific object, naturally becomes an object of curiosity, if not of suspicion. If the stranger so arriving be evidently a poor man, his poverty acts as a wet blanket upon this curiosity, and he is left to himself. At any rate, no more notice is taken of him than that manifested by the 101 questions as to who, what, whence, why, and whither, to which all newcomers are naturally subjected in a country so desirous of general information as the United States. But where a party is seen to display so glittering an exterior as that exhibited by the Allen Barnaby race, the sensation produced is very considerable, and such a hospitable manoeuvre as that above described is likely enough to be resorted to, in order to elicit the real object of their crossing the Atlantic besides that of looking at the most glorious country under the sun. Major Allan Barnaby was not that soft, as the Yankees express it, to feel the slightest doubt as to the cause of the amiable eagerness with which his acquaintance appeared to be sought, and while in the very act of bowing his acquiescence to the agreeable proposal, he made up his mind to turn the cross-examination to account. "Capital claret that, and capital whiskey this," said the beloved of our heroine, as he imbibed the first sip of the favourite mixture, by which a single glass of claret all round was followed. "What a glorious country this is, gentlemen! Cross the Atlantic to visit it. Upon my soul, though I am no longer so young as I was, I should think nothing of sailing a dozen times round the world in the regular Captain Cook style, only to get a look at it." "We do count it a pretty considerable fine country, sir," replied a senior member of the boarding-house mess, "and I must say that I expect the nation is gaining ground among the Europeans, for a precious sight of 'em steam over nowadays to give us a look. But I do beate a good deal, Major Barnaby, sir, if they will any of them become sufficiently availed of the real original cause of our unequalled prosperity and advancement, to do much good in the old worn-out country when they get back again. It is not that easy to reform fundamental mischief, sir, as a considerable number of your countrymen seem to suppose." "Reform, sir!" exclaimed Major Allan Barnaby, snapping his fingers. "I scorn the word. I scorn it, as I am sure, gentlemen, that you must all scorn it in your hearts. What has it done for us? Nothing, absolutely nothing. It is not reform we want, it is revolution. Has our boasted reform brought us one inch nearer to the Constitution of the United States of America? That is the question I ask, and let any one give a favorable answer if he can." "Why, for that matter," said one of the legislative gentlemen in reply, "I expect you must still pocket the affront of being told that the government of England is as far behind the government of America as your Virginia water is to our Niagara. It don't do to talk of them together, sir. You'll excuse me, but it's no manner of use to draw a parallel. The superiority on our side is that much as to make it not any way a civil subject of discourse between us." "I appreciate your delicacy, sir," replied the major with a deep sigh. "However, in my case," he added, "it is, I am happy to say, less necessary than in that of most other persons, for the fact is I am determined to shake off the yoke." Major Allan Barnaby would not have arrived at the age of 55 years with so much prosperity as we know he had done, if he had not possessed a considerable portion of that ready tact which enables a man, and a woman too, to discover if what they utter produces the effect they wish. The major, on the present occasion, perceived in an instant that a glance was sent round from eye to eye that seemed to say, "What does that mean?" And with equal rapidity of thought, he recollected that many English subjects who had thrown off the yoke had done so not solely to enjoy the happiness of visiting the great republic, but because their little monarchy had given hints that it had had enough of them. But he corrected his trifling blunder admirably. "Shake it off," he said with a deep sigh. "Alas, gentlemen, that is more easily said than done. To a man in my position I well know that the doing this effectually is impossible. I have large property in England, landed property, unfortunately, and unless I intend to turn beggar as well as republican, I cannot at once turn my back upon the country where it lies." The glances were now accompanied by a satisfactory sort of little nod that seemed to say, "All's right." "That's an unhandsome predicament," said one of the members of Congress. "But at any rate, sir, before you go back again to your poor tumble-down old place, you may gratify yourself by listening to a little first-rate eloquence in Congress, which is what not many of your nation is capable of enjoying, seeing that, naturally enough, as I think you will allow, we most times take the freedom of expressing our thoughts concerning the old country, and now and then we can't but see that if any English is present, they winces a little under the lash. However, with you, sir, as it seems, the case will be altogether different. For it is clear to see you would not mind seeing the old lady, our great-grandmother, as the young folks call her, get a box in the ear." "Not the least in the world, sir, I do assure you," replied Major Allan Barnaby with a laugh. "You may knock her about exactly as much as you like. I promise you I shall never interfere to protect her." The major then launched out on the theory of government, and exerted himself to the utmost to prove his entire conviction that the republican form was the only one to which any reasonable man would willingly submit himself. But a good deal to his surprise, he found that all his new acquaintance began to yawn, and display symptoms, more or less equivocal, of finding his conversation exceedingly tiresome. Major Allen Barnaby was not a man easily induced to doubt his own powers when he chose to exert them, and yet he could not but suspect now that there must be some deficiency of warmth and vigour in his eloquence, and being exceeding anxious to inspire, if possible, a little of the ardent sort of admiration which had rewarded his lady's exertion in the South, he started off anew, taking the glorious and immortal Washington for his theme, and protesting that his code, and his only, was that to which regenerated Europe would henceforward be willing to submit herself. But again his audience yawned, and it is possible that the expression of his countenance was indicative of surprise, mortification, or both, for the gentleman who sat immediately opposite to him said, with a funny sort of smile, "You must not take it ill, Major Barnaby, sir, if you don't find us New Yorkers overmuch given to reason about principles and politics and all that sort of thing, for to say the truth, there is not one of us cares a button about it from first to last. You mentioned just now, sir, that you had made for New Orleans when you crossed, and there now they will talk about principles and the rights of ownership, and the natural difference between freeborns and slaves from July to eternity. But the thing is quite different here. We don't care a cent about principles, having quite enough to do looking after principle. Do you bite, sir? That's the reason why you do not find us altogether so much taken with your very good and estimable notions as we otherwise might be. But perhaps, sir, you are not yourself at all in the mercantile line, and in that case I expect you'll find that you are considerably thrown out among us." "Not mercantile, my dear sir," returned the major. "You are altogether mistaken in that supposition, I do assure you. Few men have speculated more largely or more variously than myself, and I am at this very moment looking out for a good opportunity of investing a tolerably large sum of money in any concern in this country that is satisfactorily established and promises tolerably well." People talk of the brilliant effect of a sudden burst of sunshine upon a landscape, and it is certainly very striking. But what is it when compared to that produced by this last sentence of Major Allen Barnaby? Every eye kindled, every head was brought forward, every ear seemed to erect itself, every nostril to expand, as if game were afoot, and each living creature there instantly straining upon the slips to pursue it. The clever major saw that he had made a hit, and immediately assumed a quiet, meditative air, as if the subject touched him too nearly to permit its being lightly discussed. He no longer continued to be the principal speaker as before, but stirred his hot toddy, and appeared more inclined to hear than to be heard. But there was no longer any danger that the conversation should flag. First, the gentleman next him on the right hand began to open up the subject of banks by a leading observation muttered in his ear, and then the gentleman to the left said decisively, as he began mixing a second tumbler, "Part ownership in a good vessel well engaged and well manned is out and out the best venture going," while a third from another point hemmed aloud in order to command attention, and then pronounced with all the dignity of a lawgiver, which indeed he was, that there were shares now on sale in a canal that he could mention, a deal surer in the way of property than the Bank of England, and bringing a certain return of from 20 to 30% instead of 3, adding, with an intelligent nod of the head, "I should be happy to talk with you a little, sir, on that subject, whenever you happen to be at leisure." The major now, in an extremely short space of time, felt that he knew his company as well as if he had passed a year with them, and cleverly enough did he contrive to propitiate them all. Not a word they uttered seemed lost upon him. Nay, if two or three of them spoke together, he still contrived, by some grimace or other, to make each believe that he was the individual to whom, if the other gentleman would permit it, he most desired to listen. All this answered very well as far as it went, but it was rather dull work, too, for the major to go on talking for an hour together about dollars and dollars, and yet never once to hear the exhilarating words bet or stake. However, he knew perfectly well that there were more ways than one by which a man of genius might turn his wit to profit, and the sitting broke up at last with precisely the sort of speeches about being happy to make his acquaintance which he desired to receive. And make his acquaintance in some way or other he was quite determined they should, though he felt that it would require rather more time than at New Orleans to decide in what way it might be done with the best chance of conducing to the one great end he ever had in view. Chapter 35.
The ladies think they should prefer a spell at the Springs, but the Major prefers remaining at New York. Some account of the adventures which he meets with there. Mrs. Allen Barnaby, meanwhile, did not absolutely lose her time, for she talked to everybody who would listen to her, about her house in Curzon Street, and going to court, and holding something very like a court at home, and, in short, she did her own honours with the greatest possible perseverance and energy. Her success, however, if not altogether equivocal, was at best but various. The New York ladies, even those who occasionally take a spell of boarding, are considerably ahead of such of their southern sisters as have not traversed the Atlantic, and though the velvets and satins did a good deal towards standing in the place of introductions, they did not do quite so much as she expected. My observant heroine, too, now found the difference between addressing herself to a master passion and letting it alone. Had she presented as presents to her new companions some of her most precious and transferable articles of finery, instead of merely displaying them, it is possible that she might have advanced more rapidly in their good graces, inasmuch as it has been repeatedly asserted by analytical-minded travellers that the master passion of the majority of fair ones at New York is dress. But no such expedient suggested itself either to Mrs. Allen Barnaby or her daughter. The latter, indeed, had by no means permanently recovered her good humour, still considering herself as one of the most cruelly treated specimens of human genius on record, and believing firmly, and hinting plainly, that nothing but her mother's jealous envy of the fame that awaited her had caused her being thus violently withdrawn from the profession she had embraced with so much enthusiasm. My heroine, on the contrary, with that fine buoyancy of spirits which ever distinguished her, suffered not herself to be depressed in the slightest degree by discovering that for the time being she was not likely to make any particular use or profit from the folks around her. Instead of yielding to any such useless and enervating weakness, she recapitulated clearly and distinctly in her well-trained and able mind the various sources of solid profit which she and her spouse between them had contrived to find on a soil rather more famed for acquiring money than for yielding it. The sum total of these successes was respectable in amount, and the time consumed by the acquirement of it comparatively short. Wherefore she very reasonably determined to make use of the unavoidable interval of exertion, which now seemed to have occurred, by enjoying herself without repining or regret. The Major, meanwhile, was more than usually silent as to the nature of his occupations, but gave her to understand every morning when they separated after breakfast that she would not see him again till they met at dinner, and in like manner when the company left the dinner-table he just found time to say, "Don't expect me till you see me, my dear," and no more. Night and morning, indeed, when in the retirement of their own apartment, the wife asked and the husband answered many questions. But though she questioned with the boldness of a wife, and he answered with even more than the usual courtesy of a husband, the chief information given and received consisted in the fact that he had as yet no intelligence to communicate sufficiently definite to make it worth while to talk about it. "Then, I suppose, Major," she replied, "we may all amuse ourselves as we like, till you give orders for right about wheel."
"Exactly so, my charming wife," he answered gaily. "I am just spying here and peeping there and listening everywhere to find out if anything is to be made of these New Yorkers. If there is, I'll let you know, my dear, and maybe we'll draw up here and take breath a little before we go any further. If not, we'll be off in double-quick time, you may depend upon it."
"That is just as it should be, Donny," said she.
"I trust everything most implicitly to you," said he, "and feel no anxiety whatever, my dear, in leaving you entirely to yourself."
"Just tell me, Donny, will you," she rejoined, "how much do you pay a head for us here by the week?"
"What makes you ask, my dear? Do you want to be economical and go somewhere else in the hope of finding it cheaper?" said he.
"No, indeed, Major," she replied briskly. "I have no such stingy notions in my head, I promise you. Why should I? I am sure that altogether we have done most uncommonly well since we came here, and you know of old that I am one of those who think money, like everything else, is just worth as much as it will bring. So don't fancy that I want to creep into a hole and get half-starved and half-poisoned in order to save a few dollars while my purse is as full as it is just at present. That's not what I am thinking of, but I'll tell you what it is. As long as you go on engaged for everlasting out of the house, I see no good reason why Patty and I should stay in it if we can amuse ourselves better elsewhere. And my belief is that we might go to the Springs at Saratoga just as cheap as staying here.
As far as I am concerned, I am quite sure there's nothing to be got in the way of profit out of any of the people I am likely to make acquaintance with here, and not much between you and I in the way of amusement. So if you'll just shovel out as many dollars as would clear Patty, Tornarino, and me for a fortnight in this house, we'll just bundle ourselves off to the Springs, Donny, and if we find anything going on there in your way, my dear, I'll take care to write and let you know."
"And a very good plan, too, my Barnaby," replied the Major, nodding his head approvingly. "I can't quite tell yet whether I shall screw anything in any way out of the queer chaps here. At any rate, it won't be in the old way if I do, and so you may take Tornarino with you and welcome."
"That's all right, then," replied my heroine, "for Madame Patty would never have been contented without him. But why, I should like to know," she added with a coaxing sort of smile, "are you grown so monstrously mysterious, my dear? Whether you have any thoughts of standing for president, or whether you expect that you'll talk them into making you commander-in-chief of their army, if they happen to have one, I have no more notion than the child unborn. You never used to be so very, very cautious before, Donny."
"Upon my soul, it is no caution, wife, but wholly and solely because I have nothing to tell you that I tell you nothing. These chaps are the queerest folks you ever saw in your life, my Barnaby. There is no making out what they want to be at. From the very moment I gave them to understand, which I did in a very easy off-hand sort of way, that I had ready money with me, they have been hanging about me like wasps round a honeycomb, and it is as clear as the sun at noonday that they both hope and expect to get something out of me. But I shall be surprised if they do. Shan't you, my dear?"
"I think I should be a little disappointed, Donny," replied his wife, with the pretty complimentary bow. "But it seems to me a sad loss of time, my dear, to stay here, just taking care of yourself and nothing more. I confess," she added, "that I don't see, from what you now say, any very good reason why we should not all start together. There is always something going on, you know, at watering places, and whether it is little or much, it must be better than nothing, or then just watching to see which way these land sharks mean to set about grabbing you, merely for the pleasure of disappointing them."
"Why, yes, Mrs. Allen Barnaby, if that were quite all, I should be perfectly of your opinion," replied the Major. "But I cannot help thinking that if they once fairly set about diddling me, as we call it, I should somehow or other be able to turn the tables on them."
"Well," she returned, "I dare say you know best, Major, and therefore I most certainly shall not think of arguing the point with you. What say you, then, my dear, to our giving notice to-day that we three mean to be gone when the current week is up?"
"Why, my dear," he replied, "I say that I think it is the best thing you can do." The matter being thus amicably settled between them, the projected plan was put into execution without delay or difficulty of any kind, and Mrs. Allen Barnaby, with her daughter and son-in-law, set off for the Springs of Saratoga, their European finery being recruited by some of the most striking articles that New York could furnish, and their spirits in that happy state of excitement which arises from the consciousness of having nothing but amusement as an occupation, and nothing but whim as a master. End of chapters 34 and 35.
Chapter 36 of The Barnabys in America by Francis Milton Trollope. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Chapter 36. Mrs. Allen Barnaby writes a fascinating account of the Springs to the Major, which produces a longing desire on his part to repair thither. He hastens to bring his New York business to a conclusion, and succeeds. Among the gentlemen who, on the first day of Major Allen Barnaby's dining at New York, had pressed round him with civilities of all kinds, and offers of commercial aid and assistance in particular, in whatever speculation might attract his attention, there were two who stuck to him very much more closely than the rest. These two gentlemen, Mr. Cropp and Mr. Fadd, who had been amongst his earliest acquaintance on board the steamboat from Philadelphia, and who had paid a good deal of attention to the abundant baggage of the European travellers, had not only listened with very particular attention, indeed, to everything that had fallen from the free-spoken Major concerning the ready money he had brought out with him, but had even contrived to discover completely to their satisfaction that it had not come in the questionable form of bills of credit, the very name of which is peculiarly disagreeable to American ears, but bona fide in specie, convertible at 5 minutes' notice into the dollars upon which their heart doted. The major was fully aware of the peculiar pertinacity of these attractions, and was quite as much awake to the fact of their having some particular object in view in bestowing them as they could possibly be themselves. But far from experiencing any jealous suspicions concerning their motives, or any feeling of alarm lest any of the much-celebrated Yankee tricks should be played off against him, he wished for nothing so much as a fair trial of skill. He knew that it would not be made in the same style, or with the same weapons to which he had hitherto been the most accustomed, but either from natural generosity of temper, or a noble confidence in his own innate strength, which he knew would render him a match for most men, let them attack him in what manner they would, either from one or both of these considerations, he waited with no small degree of impatience for the opening of the campaign. It will be seen, therefore, that his statement to his wife was in every respect the most candid and sincere possible, and that he really told her nothing, solely because he had nothing to tell. Hitherto he had waited with great patience for some hint of their hopes or wishes, and he was fully determined to wait with equally great patience for some time longer, although it is certain that, either from family attachment, a love of change, or the pleasant thoughts suggested by the idea of a watering-place, he did not see the gay-looking trio set off without feeling a very considerable inclination to accompany them. Still, however, he went on for 3 days longer, drinking toddy and smoking cigars with Messrs. Crop and Fad, without committing himself by any initiative movement, and still the conversation at each sitting began and ended by general declarations on the part of the native gentleman that capital, if properly applied by those who know how to make the most of it, might just now be turned to tarnation good account, and by responses on that of the foreigner that he held the funds he had brought with him quite ready for any investment that promised a profitable return, but that of course he should look for good security. How long this sort of coquetting might have gone on, had nothing occurred to quicken the movements on either side, it is impossible to say, but the following letter spurred the sides of the major's intent so effectually as to set the machinery he had to deal with very speedily in motion.
My dear Major, this place is glorious, and unless you soon tell me of some very brilliant and successful coup de main performed at New York, I shall continue to think, as I do at present, that you are losing your time there most abominably. The springs, they say, were never so full. It was as much as ever we could do to get 2 decent bedrooms, and I can't boast much of their cheapness. However, that would not signify, you know, if you were here, Donny, exerting yourself a little. And that you might do early and late, I can tell you, for I hear the billiard balls clicking the very first thing when I open my window in the morning, and, to the best of my knowledge and belief, they go on all night. Nor is that by any means all that is going on here, I promise you. We have got as thorough-going a set of card players as ever I saw, that are always left hard at it in the great saloon when all the rest of the company go to bed. I can't, of course, pretend exactly to say what the stakes are, but instead of their nasty silver money, I observe they write on bits of paper and give one another, and I know, of old, that you always count that a good sign. Now, does not all this make you long, my dear Donny, to reunite yourself to your beloved family? However, I won't plague you about coming if you think it wisest to stay where you are, for I not only give you credit for being as attentive and thoughtful in all matters of this kind as it is possible for a man to be, but I am also modest enough to believe that you are likely to know best whether you ought to come here or whether you ought not. As to Patty, she grows handsomer and more dashing and elegant in her style and manner every day. It is 1,000 pities, to be sure, that she should be tied up to that lackpenny Tornarino, for I do think she might have had the pick of the market, go where she would. However, what can't be cured must be endured. Our nice things in the way of dress are a great help to us, I can see that plainly. Such peeping and peering at our French collars and lace. Tornarino, too, looks exceedingly well, always dressed to the life, I promise you, and I can't but say, in excuse for Miss Patty, that he looks quite the man of fashion. So that altogether our party is not to be sneezed at, and I must say that, take us one and all, I think we are the most stylish set here. This can't but be an advantage to you, Donny, if you should take it into your head to come before the season is over. But now I must say good-bye, for Patty is storming at me with her beautiful pink feathers off flying about like wild as she tosses her handsome head, because I am not ready to set off for the public walk. Once more I say, come if you can. And always, dear Donny, here, there, and everywhere, believe me to be your affectionate wife, Martha Allen Barnaby.
This letter immediately decided the major to bring matters to the point between him and his dear friends Messrs. Crop and Fad, if indeed they ever meant to come to the point at all. But at any rate he was determined to lose no more time, and if on that very afternoon he failed to discover a good chance of doing something at New York, to set off as early as possible for Saratoga. On that very afternoon, therefore, he placed himself, as usual, opposite his new friends, as soon as the dinner-party had dispersed, and stirring his toddy very assiduously, said, "Well, gentlemen, I think I must be off to the Springs after my wife and family, for I really have been making all the inquiries I can about an investment for these few troublesome thousands that I was foolish enough to bring out with me, and I can hear of nothing that would at all suit my views. Your enterprises and speculations here are all upon so large a scale that 5 or 6,000 pounds is like a drop of water in the ocean, so I have made up my mind to think no more about it. And after seeing Niagara and Boston, I mean to turn my face back again towards Europe, and content myself with some little speculation there." Mr. Crop and Mr. Fad exchanged glances, and for a moment both of them remained silent. But at length Mr. Crop, who was by far the livelier genius of the two, suddenly addressed his friend Fad in an easy and natural tone, which gave to his words the appearance of being perfectly unpremeditated.
"That would be a pity, I expect, wouldn't it, Fad? I, for one, should be right down sorry to see good, solid capital marched out of such a country as this, where it would be sure to bring a good 10 or 15%, if it was made the most of."
"I expect it would," answered Fad, shaking his head and looking quite sorry.
"Think again, Major Allen Barnaby, sir," resumed Crop, "and in the course of to-morrow morning I calculate I might hit upon something or other quite in the ready-money line of business that might suit. I could have done it before, easy enough, I make no doubt, only, truth to speak, I didn't know you were so much in earnest, or at any rate so much in a hurry."
"Why, after all, you know, Mr. Crop," said the Major, smiling, "that the disposition of a few thousands is not likely to be an object of very first-rate importance to me, and that as my family all seem exceedingly well pleased at the Springs, it is natural enough that I should feel well disposed to join them. However, I have not the least objection to wait over to-morrow, but if you do not in the course of the forenoon favour me with some sort of information a little more definite than any which you have hitherto given me, I really do not think you can blame me for leaving the city, without giving any further thought to the chances of finding a favourable investment here."
"No, sir, no blame whatever.
In course you will be after doing in that respect whatever may happen to the most agreeable to yourself," said Mr. Crop with great civility, and then added, "At present, to be sure, we only seem to be talking for talking's sake, that I must confess. What say you, Fad, to look in at the Bowery?" he added with an air of indifference.
This proposition seemed to be well relished by Mr. Fad, and the two gentlemen departed together, leaving the Major to amuse himself again, as he had repeatedly done before since his arrival, by getting a little picking at chicken billiards at some of the, comparatively speaking, harmless tables of the commercial city.
"Well, Fad," said his friend Crop, as arm in arm they sauntered off together,
"I really think you must consent to expedite matters a little. I expect, my fine fellow, that it can make no great difference to you whether you are declared bankrupt 2 months hence or 6.
"I expect not much," replied Fad gaily. "The fact is that I have a notion my lady is dubitating whether she shan't take a house and give a ball, and I was calculating, you see, that it might be more profitable to give it before than after, on account of clearing off expenses."
"Why, so it might, I expect, a trifle, but nothing comparable to what we should both lose if we should suffer this chap to escape," replied Mr. Crop. "And as to time, though I would be the last man in the world to vex dear Mrs. Fad by disappointing her about her ball, the whole business will take so little time to get through that I don't consider it will signify a cent to her, one way or the other. The smash will be over, and you up again, and as good a man as ever, before the winter season is over."
"Oh, dear, yes, I know that perfectly well," replied Fad. "I am that much used to it, like the most of us, that I don't mind at the value of that," snapping his fingers. "And therefore I'm your man, either for drawing or backing, or anything you like."
"That will do, then," replied Crop. "If you are ready, the job is, and I won't say but what I shall enjoy it, for it's plain to see that this gay London officer fancies himself a devilish deal sharper than anybody as he is likely to meet with here. The very fact of his bringing his money out here to speculate with proves that fact. Don't you see, Fad?
if he did not think us that soft that he would take some advantage or other of us, do you think he would have taken the trouble to steam out here for the sake of investing his thousands? Not he, take my word for it. He thinks to do us, Mr. Fad, and we'll just see one way and away if we can't do him."
"Oh, but you forget, Crop," rejoined Fad, with a roguish sort of wink, "you forget the gentleman's political principles. Don't you know that he has come out here out of pure love for our Constitution?"
"All that's very well when there's no money in the case, Mr. Washington Fad," replied the candid Republican. "But the moment a man mixes up any question of money with his politics, I know, and so do we all, I expect, pretty considerably well on this side of the Atlantic, which is the substance and which is the shadow."
"You may say that, Mr. Jefferson Crop," returned his friend, laughing. "But by the stars and the stripes, you must not waste any more time in being witty, for if I am to put things in train, to declare myself bankrupt in 2 months, I must be tarnation active to-day, to-morrow, and the day after, I calculate, and therefore I must begin by begging you to go over the whole transaction, as it is to be done and performed for our mutual profit and advantage."
"I have got it all as clear in my head as rock crystal," said Mr. Crop, "and I expect he'll do his part of it as gentle as a lamb. At our next meeting I'll tell him that you have got an unaccountable good opportunity of buying your wife's brother's share of a fine property in Ohio, but that for a few months you must borrow a few $1,000s, for which you are willing to give good interest."
"Why, you don't mean to come upon him smack with a proposal to borrow his money, do you?" said Fad, shaking his head. "That will never do."
"I expect not, Mr. Fad. I should like to know whereabouts you think I was hatched. However, here we are at the Bowery. I'll explain it all when we come out. Our path is as straight before us as the Broadway."
With these words, Mr. Crop pushed open the spring doors of the theatre and entered, followed by his friend. On the following morning, Major Allen Barnaby had the pleasure of finding his new friend, Mr. Crop, better than his word, for instead of keeping him waiting till noon for the intelligence he had only half promised to obtain for him, he took him aside when they met at breakfast, for the purpose of saying that he had now got an opportunity, in a little way, of showing him what sort of interest might be obtained for money at New York, by those who thought it worth their while to look about for it. And then he proposed a walk on the Battery, to give them a leisurely and quiet interval for explanation. Major Allen Barnaby readily agreed to accompany him, and they set off together, Mr. Fad excusing himself from joining the party on account of business elsewhere.
"You must not fancy, sir," said the American, as soon as they found themselves on one of the quiet walks of the beautiful promenade they had sought, "you must not fancy, Major, that I have been lucky enough to hit upon any grand and great speculation for you. No such thing. That would require a little more time than you have allowed me, I expect. But I shall just be able to show you that I have not been talking of what I did not understand when I spoke to you of the rate of interest in New York. Without disbursing a single cent of your capital, you may get at the rate of 20% for only accepting a bill of Fad's. I'll let him have the money with all the pleasure in life, for I know my man, and instead of $10,000 I'd be happy and proud to lend him $50,000. But one does not get such a chance as that in a hurry. Fad wants the money all in a hop, you see, to purchase his wife's brother's share of a fine property in Ohio that must be sold by auction out and out directly, because the father, you see, is dead. Upon these $10,000 you and I shall make a pretty trifle each by dividing the interest, though it's only for a few months. But that's the way we do business in New York. What do you say to it, Major Allen Barnaby?"
"Why, I cannot but feel greatly obliged to you, sir, for letting me share this profitable trifle with you," replied the Major. "But if you know Mr. Fad so well, as being himself a perfectly responsible person, why should you require an endorsement?"
"As far as I'm concerned," returned Crop, "I would not give a single levy for it. But it is the custom, you know. The fact is that the moneyed men of New York have made it a sort of law, expressly for the purpose of turning a few $1,000s in the year by just signing their names."
"Aye, aye, I see, I understand," said the Major, looking perfectly satisfied, "and I shall be quite ready to give my name for the consideration you mention, which I presume is paid in advance."
"Certainly, Major, it is always paid in advance," said Crop. "But you must see Fad, of course, and settle all about it with him. And perhaps, when the bill is drawn and endorsed, you may as well hand it over to me at my counting-house yourself, for the interest is a little sharpish even for New York, and I see no good to any of us in putting the transaction before the eyes of anybody but the parties concerned."
I'll tell Fad that you will be with him in an hour, shall I?" "If you please, sir, I will not fail to be punctual," returned the major. And after receiving a card with Mr. Fad's commercial address, he returned to the boarding-house and employed himself upon some little jobs that he had to do in his own room till it was time to set off again to keep his appointment. When Major Allen Barnaby reached the counting-house of Mr. Fad, he found that gentleman seated there alone in the enjoyment of a solitary cigar, with a considerable mass of papers, ledgers, and account-books ranged on the table before him. "Your servant, Major Allen Barnaby," he said as the gentleman entered. "You are punctual, sir, and that's the very soul of business. I often say that I have made as much money by my punctuality as by my knowledge of business, and that is setting my value for it considerable high, I expect. Pray be seated, sir." The major accepted the invitation, and immediately entered upon the business that brought him there, observing that their friend Mr. Crop had promised to be ready at his own counting-house to complete the transaction forthwith. "I know he will," returned Fad. "Crop is one of the best fellows that ever lived. He knows that it is an object with me to be ready to step in with my money immediately, as there is a chance that I may lose the bargain if I don't, and I should reckon that a good 3,000 out of my pocket, considering the pretty bit of property that I have got next lot to it. And now, sir, here is pen and paper all ready. Shall I draw and you accept, or you draw and I back it?" "I'll draw it, if you will," replied the major carelessly. The materials for doing so were placed before him, and he began to write. "I can't say much in praise of your pens, Mr. Fad," he said, first trying one and then another of those that stood in the inkstand before him. "Perhaps, sir," he added, "you would be kind enough to give a touch to one of them with your penknife. We Englishmen, Mr. Fad, are natty about our pens, and I confess I like to write my name legibly, whether for $10,000 or £10,000. Mr. Fad instantly started up and retreated with a quill to the window, saying, "If you are natty in using pens, Major Allen Barnaby, we count ourselves natty in making them. If you'll wait 1 minute, sir, you shall have one fit to imitate copper plate." And he set himself assiduously to the task of turning a goose quill into a pen. "Don't trouble yourself, Mr. Fad," said the major when the pen was about half made. "I have found one that will do exceedingly well. Now then, sir, have the kindness to endorse it without losing time, for I have promised Mr. Griskin to cross to Hoboken with him before dinner, and it is as much as I shall be able to do to bring the money to you here, and then get to the ferry by the time we agreed upon." "I will not detain you an instant, my dear sir," cried Mr. Fad, hastening back to the table, where the major, who had completed his part of the business, was employed in carefully pressing the bill on a sheet of blotting paper, holding in his hand another morsel of the same material in readiness for the endorsement, that no time might be lost, yet no danger of blotting ensue. "You will be here, Mr. Fad," said the major, carefully folding up the bill and placing it in his pocket-book. "I must beg that you won't go till I return, for I shall by no means choose to cross the ferry with all this money about me." "I think I told you, my dear sir, that I could not leave the office till my clerk came back. You may depend upon finding me." Having received this assurance, our friend posted off with all speed to the counting-house of his other new acquaintance, whom he found sitting alone much in the same style as he had found Mr. Fad. After being again complimented on his punctuality, the major said, "I suppose you and Mr. Fad understand one another, sir, and therefore I have drawn this bill here according to his instructions, though the sum is double what you named to me." The first words of this speech caused Mr. Crop to start slightly, but the conclusion not only chased the feeling of alarm to which the opening had given rise, but produced a well-pleased though involuntary smile which spoke, as plainly as a smile could speak, that the alteration mentioned was anything rather than disagreeable. Neither the start nor the smile were lost upon the observant major, and he, too, would have smiled in his turn had he not thought it more advisable to look grave. "There, sir," he added, laying down a bill drawn by him on Mr. Fad for $20,000, and bearing that honourable gentleman's acceptance on the back of it. "There, sir, is the bill, according to the request of your friend, for $20,000 instead of ten, an increased accommodation to him, to which he said you had agreed." "Quite right, sir, quite true," replied Mr. Crop, applying himself as he spoke to an iron strong-box which stood ready on the table. "I told him, as I believe I told you, that I should not have the slightest objection to advance him 50,000 if he wanted it. I won't say," he continued, but what I should have tried to make a better bargain for my friend Fad if I had known in the first instance, when I opened the business to you, that the sum would have been so large. It's getting a pretty sum considerable easy, I expect, Major Allen Barnaby."
"Very true, sir," replied the major, rather dryly. "Had it been otherwise, I certainly should not have accepted the proposal at all, for I detest trouble."
While this was passing, Mr. Crop continued drawing a heap of dirty American bank paper from his strong-box till the sum of $20,000 was laid before Major Allen Barnaby, who presented the bill to Mr. Crop in return for it, and then took his leave, saying, "I have promised Mr. Fad to return with the money instantly, so I must wish you good morning."
"Good morning, sir, good morning,"
returned the civil Mr. Crop, attending him politely to the door, and so parted those two bright specimens of the old world and the new. But in this instance, at least, if in no other, the Englishman proved by far the most accomplished knave of the two, at least if success be taken in proof of superiority. For the well-timed bankruptcy of the excellent Mr. Fad, which was, of course, to throw the whole responsibility on our friend, had no more power to prevent the flitting of the active major than it had to prevent his drawing $20,000 instead of $10,000. In short, the Englishman proved himself the harder and sharper diamond of the two. The major kept his promise very punctually to the eagerly expectant Mr. Fad, paying over to him $10,000 of the sum he had received. But changing his mind as to his project of visiting the pleasant shades of Hoboken, he immediately returned to the boarding-house, accompanied by a porter, to whose truck he consigned all the remaining baggage of the party, having taken care, before he made his last exit, to leave it all in a state ready for removal. But let it not be supposed for a moment that Major Allen Barnaby meant to make a clandestine escape from his quarters. On the contrary, he took the most handsome and honourable leave possible of the master of the establishment, paying him rather more than a week in advance, and expressing the most flattering regret at being thus suddenly obliged to leave a residence he had so greatly enjoyed, and a city he had so greatly admired, in consequence of a letter just received from his daughter, announcing the painful intelligence that his beloved wife had been suddenly taken ill, and wished him to rejoin her instantly. Mr. Paring of the boarding-house received both the dollars and the farewell with great politeness, and in less than a quarter of an hour afterwards, the major, his trunks, and his pocket-book were on board the Atalanta steamboat bound to Albany, to which place he very audibly told the porter he was going in the hearing of one white and one black domestic at the boarding-house. End of chapter 36.